Thank you, Uday. Good evening to you all. Welcome to all the participants and the resource person of today's webinar, Sri J. Santhana Krishna Garu, for the webinar series on challenges in advanced electronics and communication. Coming to our institution, Chalapathi Institute of Technology, Mothadaka, was established in the year 2008 by Sri YB Anjaneyal Garu and is accredited with NAC A grade. At present, we are offering 7 undergraduate courses, 5 postgraduate courses, and 4 diploma courses with a total intake of 894. Since the inception of the institution, we are giving topmost priority in imparting high quality technical education to the students, and at the same time we are giving top priority for conducting various programs like faculty development programs, seminars, guest lectures for the benefit of the students, faculty, research scholars, and the people from the industry. At present, due to this pandemic situation, we are concentrating on conducting webinars and online faculty development programs. Already we have completed 17 programs so far. This is the 18th program, and this today webinar series, that is challenges in advanced electronics and communication, this webinar series is intended to provide the opportunity for the electronics and communication students, faculty members, and research scholars to enhance their knowledge in the area of advanced wireless communications and also VLSI design challenges and ECAD tools, and this will help in identifying the research problems and solutions to the various research problems. And on this occasion, I express our heartfelt thanks to Sri J. Santhana Krishna Garu, Deputy General Manager retired BSNL Chennai, who immediately accepted our invitation and came forward to deliver this webinar. At the same time, I extend my wishes to our Professor in ECE, Dean Research and Development, Dr. P. Balamurli Krishna Garu, for making this program. I also thank Udaykaran Garu, our IQAC coordinator, for making elaborate arrangements for conducting this today's webinar. I express my thanks to Nagaravikanna Garu, HOD ECE department, and the faculty members for the successful conducting of this program. Thank you, one and all.
Shall I start? Santhana Krishnan, shall I start?
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Namaskaram, sir. I request Balamurli Garu. I request Balamurli Garu will give the brief note about this program.
Thank you, Uday. I heartily welcome all the participants to this today webinar on challenges in advanced electronics and communication. As part of this program, today we have the first session by J. Santhana Krishna Garu, Deputy General Manager, retired Chennai. And we have another program tomorrow. So that is on VLSI design challenges and tools by Dr. N. Balaji Garu, Professor JNTUK. Sri J. Santhana Krishna Garu has vast experience in telecommunication and mobile communication, and he served the Department of Telecommunications and BSNL for more than 35 years. And he's acting as guest faculty in different universities and colleges also. By keeping his experience and expertise in our minds, we invited the respected sir for giving this wonderful session on advanced wireless communication, which is the emerging technology now. We focused on 5G and beyond 5G. Currently we are using 4G, and we are moving towards, we are marching towards the 5G. So that's why we focused on 5G now. I thank Santhana Krishna Garu for accepting our request and giving your consent to act as resource person for this wonderful program. Thank you, sir. And I wish all the best to all the participants, and thank you for your support. Thank you all.
Krishnan sir, over to you. Please start your lecture, sir.
Thank you, sir. Good evening to all. First of all, I would like to thank Dr. Balamurshali Krishna and the administration for giving me an opportunity to be with you all this evening. Also, I profusely apologize for my inability to be in the morning session, and I posted all of Murali Krishna Garu to postpone it. I again profusely apologize, and then for my this one. Anyway, now I will do this program now. Thank you all participants. Now the topic of the day is advanced wireless communication. We are going to discuss about fifth generation and what is going to happen in beyond 5G. What will be the wireless communication strategy in 2030? So that is the discussion of the day. Now we will move on to this program. The motivation for the program is that just I will prepare a ground for wireless communication, then we will go inside the conceptual foundation, then we will discuss about all generations 1G to 3G, and then we will go why there is a need for development of fourth generation wireless communication, then we will step into fifth generation technology, we will have some deliberation on that, then we will discuss about the vision 2030, that means what is going to happen in sixth generation technology. It is not going to stop with the fifth, it is going to go for a sixth, and where you will be there in 2030. That is okay. Now, all of you are, I am audible to all of you. I am okay.
Sir, increase.
Audible?
Sir, somewhat low, sir.
Okay. Now I will do. Okay.
Okay, sir, okay.
Right. Now, the learning objective, I will tell you now, at the end of the, I find that all of them are academicians and research scholars. I think there are no students, okay? And at the end of the session, I plan that all the participants will get a very good exposure on the technological advancements in the wireless communication technologies. The research scholars will get an exciting triggers in the new area where you can do research. I'll then and then make a mention about where we can do the research. Faculty will get adequate comfort level to bridge the industry academia digital divide. Whenever you go and then make a program to the students, you will get a very good comfort level about the what is happening in the industry, because I happen to be from the industry and then having exposure over around 40 years. From 1970, I am there in the communication field continuously, both in teaching and the technology. Okay, now the course outline is wireless communication, then wireless networking technologies. I will discuss about Wi-Fi, Bluetooth, cellular, and wireless sensor network, some bits and all, make a foundation, tell the mobile communication basic elements. Then we'll discuss about GSM and GPRS. Then I will go to 3G mobile communication, what is the standards architecture, and then how the video call support is made, why we have to move towards 4G, what is the evolution of 5G, where, why, what is the meaning of densification, cloudification, and disaggregation, then what are the vision and the key features of 6G and wireless technologies for 2030. This is a course outline. I'll be there with you for 2 hours. I'll be there up to 6 o'clock, and then I wish that all of you will have a very nice experience with me in this session. Now, moving on to that, wireless networks, I've just like a super.
Sir.
Yes.
Sir, your voice is somewhat low, sir.
Okay,
please make some adjustment.
1 minute. I'll just make like this. Is it okay now?
Sir, video is off now. Nothing to worry. You please keep laptop with you, sir.
Don't worry about video. Now I am keeping my iPad nearer to my face, so
okay,
that audibility will be fine. Okay.
Now it, yes, sir.
Okay. Now wireless networks, and why? Yeah, all of you know what is wireless. There is no medium, either fiber or the copper wire, and it is an air interface. And then the computing has to be there on the move. And then you have wireless network like Wi-Fi, Bluetooth and all, and then you have the cellular networks, and I will give you some concept about what is ad hoc networks and all. Okay, now if you go for the mobile environment, there are certain limitations. So the limitations maybe is the bandwidth, then frequent disconnections, and then if that is a heterogeneity of fragmented network. Heterogeneity means now I am on the Wi-Fi, I move on to the Bluetooth, from Bluetooth I move into the mobile, then that means there are different networks are there. That is one thing. And then when you move from one base station to another base station, the signal level is there, and then they say you are outside the coverage area. These are all the problems of the fragmented networks. And then there's a route breakages. If you go on a vehicle or the car and all, if the speed is increasing, the network is not able to take care of your mobility speed and everything. So the design takes care that the speed of the mobility also is taken care in every generations. And then limitation of the mobile device. You have seen some 4 or 5 years back, you know, you cannot do anything from the mobile. It was so heavy and bulky. And now you find that the mobile handset is replacing your laptop or the computer. And there is a limitation of the battery, the screen size and everything. Okay. Now coming to wireless and then wired network. Now, when you move on from, see, the limitation of the wired network is the bandwidth and other problem. And when you come to the wireless network, then you require a frequency. And the frequency, there must be a regulation is there, and there will be the problem of bandwidth, and there will be delay when the packet is moving from one point to another. It is getting transmitted, there is a delay in the transmission, and therefore you get a latency, and there is a packet loss will be there, and there will be the medium will become shared. You are finding your MAC interface is there, and then there will be the medium is going to get shared by so many people in the air interface. Okay, so these are all the issues which you have to be addressed to the wireless, which are not there in the wired interface. It is wired network, it is all fixed. Okay, but now wired network, whether it is going to be there in the future or not is a question. When copper wire networks are coming there, it is getting outdated. Nowhere now copper network is not going to be there. Whereas now you find that fiber network is going to be there in the market. That is going to be the future. Wire, that is there. Okay. Now our aim is whether you'll be able to get the bandwidth what you are getting in the fiber network, whether that can be got in your wireless network. There the game starts. The generation of mobile technology, the game changer is only that. We want to get the bandwidth. And whatever getting in the fiber network, the same thing whether we are able to get in the wireless or not. Okay, today we cannot get terabyte transmission, that is lambda transmission. So what are that is the capacity of a fiber where it can transmit at the lambda level? Okay, that is the lambda level. I mean, it is a terabyte. Capacity. Whether that can be done in the wireless. So that is where we are now going. Okay. Now, the effect of mobility is going to have in the OSI layer. All the 7 layer, you are going to have the problem. This slide I specifically put for the research scholars, because in the mobile communication, if you take wireless mobile communication, in the application level, if you take the Android, you can see wonders what people doing in the application. They develop unlimited number of applications that it has to have a cross-layer optimization. Okay, you have to think in that way. The transport, then there is a congestion and flow control is there. There you find the data communication, you could have found the difference between the TCP/IP and the UDP. TCP, there is a quality service there. Then packet loss cannot be allowed. If the packet loss is there, it will ask a retransmission. In the UDP, that is not there. But you cannot have a TCP for a music or a video transmission because bandwidth is very heavy. There we have to go for UDP protocol. Okay, so all these things are to be taken care of in the transport and the network. Now, a lot of changes have taken place. Layer 3 protocol, layer 2 protocol. You can skip layer 2 and then go for layer 3, or layer 3 you can skip and then come to layer 2. There are switches available in the market. And these are the areas where we can concentrate on the research, and they are going to have a very good impact on this mobility. Okay, and then physical. physical transmission, what I mean is, you find that any wireless technologies, the backhaul is the fiber, or it is a microwave. Now, microwave is costly, and then you have to pay for air interface. Therefore, people go for the fiber. So, it is end-to-end communication, it's not wireless. So, only from the base transmitting station to your mobile, it is wireless. From the base transmitting station to another mobile base station station for the called side, that will be a fiber backhaul. Okay. Now, in the physical transmission, how are you going to enhance when the wireless technology is getting improved and the fiber technology and the backhaul also is getting improved? Both of them are not getting matching. The simple reason, fiber has got a very good bandwidth of the terabit level, whereas in the wireless communication level, we are not able to go beyond some megabits. So that is the problem now we are facing. Okay. So what we have to do, the designers, the network designers, we have to concern about the, see, we cannot provide a new technology without any cost, but it should be cost effective. If the mobile phone is going to cost 1 lakh, people will not purchase. So the cost has to reduce, and then the design has to become simple. The network users, the applications, how many applications you are going to put? So that is another challenge for network providers. For me, the management of security and then fault tolerance is very important. Now we find, now you have provided Wi-Fi in your college campus. If DDoS attack is taking place, the network administrator, that service provider, is responsible because he is providing you the IP address. So that IP address has to be blocked. Then you have to go to him. So he is more concerned in the future. The wireless wireless communication technologies parlance, more and more devices are going to be connected. Billions of devices are going to be connected in the market or in the world. Every one user is going to have minimum 5 to 6 devices connected. Every one of them will have minimum 5 to 6 IP addresses. If so, how are you going to manage? So that administration is going to be, is a very big challenge. Okay. And now, factors affecting the wireless system design. So what are all the challenges in the wireless system design? Mainly is the frequency allocation. You find that thousands of crores of money has to be given to the government for taking the spectrum, for providing the last mile interface, the air interface by the operators. So in later stages, I just tell you now, there's a free spectrum available, and then spectrum on cost also is available. How are you going to make it? And then how are you going to improve the multi-access mechanism? And then antenna is going to give very important, very, very, very important role on this development of wireless technologies, because there is a multi-input, multi-output smart antennas have come. That is one of the ingredients of the 4G communication. Okay. So then signal encoding and then error correction, these are all the issues. Okay. So these factors are going to affect the wireless system design. And then we see, coming to the frequency, you find the frequency slot. Again, many of you would have seen. Now, our area, coaxial cable, you have seen VLF to UHF. Okay. Now, coaxial cable is there, right? And then VHF to UHF, we have that 300 megahertz to 30 gigahertz. So in this range, our present GSM, global system mobile, the 2.5G and 3G, whatever phone now you are using, and it is working on 900 megahertz spectrum, 1800 megahertz spectrum, 2100 megahertz spectrum. So it is working. So it is working in this range. So I want to make you understand that the frequency is one of the very important. Here one concept you perhaps will be knowing, spectrum efficiency. What is spectrum efficiency? I am purchasing spectrum from the government. They will give you only 25 megahertz. Even though it is 900 megahertz range, all the operators, they have to give 25 megahertz only. They will give 25 megahertz. You have to build up so many lakhs of customers. Okay. So you design a technology in which how many bits you can pack per hertz of frequency. Hertz, that is one cycle. Hertz, how many bits per hertz? So that is called spectrum efficiency, bits per hertz. Okay, so this makes an impact on the future generation of the technology. If the design is simple, 2.5G, the number of bits are more, the number of bits are very less per hertz. Okay, If you come for 4G, 5G and other things, the number of bits are more. I will just make a mention there how the design has been made. Here there are two things. The operator gets a benefit because if the more bits can be packed per hertz by in a given spectrum, he can have more number of customers. And for me, as a customer, I get more benefits. So that is the point we have to appreciate here in the frequencies band of the communication. And how the frequency is allotted. Okay, the radio frequency, wireless communication wing is there in the Department of Telecommunication. We have two ranges. One is free range, another is there at cost, okay. The frequency range is there, microwave frequency range is given, radio frequency range is given. The mobile technology we use from 900 onwards, okay. And depending upon the technology what we are using, we will see that one, okay. And then infrared frequency is there. IHM band is the free range, okay. Industrial, medical, and then scientific, okay. So in that range, that is 2.4 gigahertz and then 5 gigahertz. Suppose you want to do some research in your lab, then you can use 2.4 gigahertz and then 5 gigahertz. Okay, now for frequencies or mobile communication, I told you in the earlier slide, VHF and UHF range, then we use the, it is as an impact on the antennas, or the your antenna, even though it becomes smaller, you find that in the tower, if you see three sectors antenna, 120 degrees, there will be three antennas, the rectangular antennas. If you raise your head and then see, there will be three antennas covering a circular radius of 120 degrees each. They're all directional antennas, okay? That is what we use in the mobile communication. Okay, now you have the wireless LAN. Wireless LAN, see, local area network, we in all our houses and this one, we, Wi-Fi, you are all very familiar. I will mention when I come to Wi-Fi. And then that Omni antenna we are using. For Wi-Fi, we use the 2.4 gigahertz and then 5 gigahertz. We have the, that is the unlicensed band I have given, and then that the agencies are there, the wpc.dot.gov.in. Okay, this is for your information, what is happening in the society. Now, for wireless transmission, we require antenna. Okay, now I'm not going into the details of the antenna because that comes under antenna fundamentals and that is a different topic. But you have to have a concept that from your handset has got a transmitter and receiver, it has got an antenna. Please remember that. Every one of your handset has got transmitter, transceiver is there, and then which is that every BTS has got there will be a transmitter and receiver. The transmitter and receiver design is very important in a wireless communication system. Okay, because the path I think in the next slide it is Yes, now we will go to this one. If you take the wireless, we have to understand the hop. The hopping, I will tell you later on in the 4G, 5G and all this concept is coming. The hop means, suppose now here, then one device is there, and then there is another device is there, and then the communication is taking place in only one step, that is called single hop. Suppose if this device is going to talk to this device, that means one hop, second hop, third hop. This is called a multi-hop, okay? There is a concept called device-to-device communication in mobile communication. And when you want to have a device-to-device communication, and our wireless sensor devices are going to talk, then the multi-hop, this one is very, very important. And the problem is, you have to receive and then transmit and then amplify the signal, okay? So the device-to-device communication is very important. If I just tell you now, Uttarakhand, when there was a damage of, that flood damage came, all the BTS has gone out of order, but the devices were able to contact from one to another, people who are nearby, and they were able to make communication. And from your control room of the mobile communication, we were able to see what are the devices which are active and other things, and that saved a lot of life. Okay, so that multi-hop wireless is becoming important in that concept. Now, in this network scenario, there are two type of network, many of you would have seen in the wireless communication book for the UG. This concept is there, infrastructure and then ad hoc network. Infrastructure is the one you can find here, that there is a LAN already fixed and then AP is wired, hardwired. So that is called infrastructure. That means once wired, you cannot go on making changes every time. But if it is ad hoc network, as and when we meet, we start communicating with each other. So in this bottom, these are all the ad hoc network. That means a network formed for the time being, then it is called ad hoc network. Suppose military, I want to set up a network, then that is the ad hoc network. Suppose now BSNL has set up a mobile tower and then switch main switching center, all these things, then it becomes an infrastructure. So just to have, the, here I am giving an idea, if you are going to do research on a mobile ad hoc network, your direction is getting changed, and you want to do in the infrastructure, your direction is getting changed. For that purpose, I just made this one. Okay, so the monad, you can see monad is not a, please remember, mobile ad hoc network is not a cellular infrastructure, it is a multi-hop wireless network. Altogether, it is a different system by itself. And data will be routed from A to B. Suppose you want to go to A to B, you have to go to this network, the node, and then this node will change as this one. Like that from here, if you want to go from this node, and then this node, you have to go. Okay. Now I will just brief, go a little faster because more available in the this one, the back. So I, okay. So now wireless networking technologies. Now I'll just make a rush. Bluetooth is there, it is there 2.4 gigahertz and then data rate is one. Then you have the Zigbee. Zigbee is, see, I'm only telling the network protocol, wireless networking technologies, wireless technologies, okay, for short haul. And there is one Z-Wave, okay, the data rate is only 9.6, the range is 30 meters, okay. And then if you see how the Zigbee is now made connected here. So now this is one Zigbee device, here there is one pair will be there. A to B, there will be two units will be there, and they will talk to each other, okay. Always the Zigbee deployed that way, okay. And now this Wi-Fi network, you know that 802.11, 2.4 or 50 gigahertz, the range is 50 meter. The data rate is, say, average is only, the maximum is 600 Mbps. Now coming to near field communication, many of you would have there, your bank ATM card, it is now coming with the, and then you have the point of sales person, the card, pay card. See, the very danger if you see that, if you have them your PAN packet, if you go nearer that one, if they show their machine, automatically the data will be getting transferred, okay. Now, then you have the GSM, okay. The GSM, you have, now I will go to the GSM in detail, therefore I will just omit that now, okay. Now, then you have another type of protocol, Sigbox is there. This is a 900 megahertz, range is 3 to 10 kilometers, and 10 bits per second. Then you have the low rate. LoRaN, and then they have a new out. I'm just telling you these terminologies because everyone, suppose you are doing project for the students, so that will be useful for them. Okay. And there is another technology, thread is there. Another technology is the 6LoWPAN is there. Okay. Low power personal area network. So these are all the wireless networking technologies. Okay, now another one is concept I will give you. It is a cognitive radio. So the cognitive radio is that, suppose now you see, there is a television channels are being broadcast, okay. So they are using a particular frequency, a particular system. 300 channels, each channel has got a frequency. In a particular location, I'm using one frequency, all other frequencies are spare. Now the cognitive radio, sensibly and then intelligently senses in that location, that particular frequency is spare, and that is made use for that instant, transmitting signals from one point to another. So that is what you are pointing here. This frequency is used here, but till the time the owner is not going to use it, because I tell you, there are so many channels. Each channel has got a frequency band, and one band only I am using, all other things are spare. Now, when this fellow start using this, now what happens? Then it starts sensing which one other use is free. The other one is made use of, sensor made use of, and then till the time that becomes free, it is shifted to another one. So this is the concept of cognitive radio. This is also one of the concept of wireless networking technology. Next networking technology is the IoT. IoT, you see, all devices, all the minute, small entities, elements are getting connected. Each one of the elements are going to be connected. So whenever they connect, they are called body area sensor network, personal area network, home area network. Okay. Home area network, and then nearby area network, then wide area network, global area network. Like that, each one of the functionalities that devices, they work on the internet. When the sensors are connected, physical event is getting transferred electrically through the device connected to the internet that we call as the IoT. In the IoT landscape, wireless networking technology is making a very good landfall because of the wireless sensor network. Wireless sensor network does sensing, processing, and networking. The sensor nodes, the physical features are converted into electrical and then they are transferred. Mainly, please, many of you would have done this sensor network, that it is now there is no address, there is no IP address. They are data-centric networks. So the physical ambience is converted into electrical signal, then they are transmitted onto the sensor nodes, collected together in the cluster. The sync node is collecting the data and then transmitting to the via the gateway network, which is addressable network, which is visible to you at a distance. Suppose that some forest fire is taking place, that is collected via the sensor network, and then it is there. So this is also an ad hoc network. It is an application-oriented network. Okay, so now you find that these are the sensor collecting by the sync node, going to the gateway, and then going to the gateway to the core network. Now, in the wireless networking technologies, there's the flavor. Wired is there, wireless personal area network, mesh network, local area network, wide area network. Okay, so I talked about these type of things and also the Zigbee and other things. Then we have the Bluetooth and other things. But wired network, you have the Ethernet, coaxial and other things. Okay, these are the things. This is only a summary. Okay, now coming to the node. I have now different flavors of the wireless networking technologies I told you. Now I am now landing onto the mobile, this one, okay. So now, if it is wireless and mobile, what are the comparisons is given here? See, wireless, there is no stationary computer. Here, mobile, there can be laptop and other things. This I have taken from Schiller, the standard book on mobile communication. It is only to make you. Now, in the earlier mobile, earlier 1946, if you find that there will be only one tower and that used to transmit frequency and the car moving from one place to another place. This is the coverage area and this is the BTS. Okay. And once it goes out of the coverage area, no signal will be there. So this was the concept. Here, this is the area, this is the base station area, the cover. Okay. So this is the very earlier mobile. Then it is there. Okay. So the disadvantage was, it's very heavy. You can see in 46, how was the technology was there. In the car, they used to carry a very big mobile and wherever they go, you know, that area, they will speak and then come back. So vehicle mounted instruments were there. This is only out of, to break your monotony, I just gave this idea. Okay. So now, I think anybody is asking questions.
No, sir. After completion of your class, we will take the questions, sir.
Okay. So somebody says they're going on calling my phone. I'll just...
You please keep switch off or otherwise in silent mode, sir. No issue.
I will do that. I will switch off. Okay, now what happened? Okay, now so wireless sensor network and then mobile communication. what is the disadvantage, I told you. And then cellular system basic ideas. Okay, now single hop wireless connectivity. I told you, the previous example, the car moving, that is a single car wire company, and the space is divided into the cells, and then there will be base station. Okay, I'll just give you the block diagram after some time. Okay, now what you have to understand, why we want a cellular system? Okay, why we want cell type system? I already explained, you cannot have millions of customers with a given 25 megahertz frequency with a single base station. One problem is we are transmitting higher frequencies, which is not good for health. You have to go for higher height, just like a broadcasting station. Once you go higher height, you cannot have number of customers. You have to reduce the height of the tower. When you reduce the height, then frequency power transmission has to be reduced. Then 25 megahertz, you have to distribute to all the people. Each one of the customer, you have to give you a 200 kilohertz. When you give 200 kilohertz, up 200, down 200 for speech, and then 400 kilohertz in 25 megahertz, if 25 into 1000 by 2000, that many number of customers only you can give. Now this is a limitation. Now what we have to do? We have to be, unless the custom, that company cannot survive. What they do? They increase the number of cells, use the frequency again. That means if a frequency used in a particular cell, they divided the entire area in a small cells, and then reused the frequency. The frequency will be reused again throughout India. They will go on reusing the same 25 megahertz and then build up the channels. Okay. So that is called cellular structure. The cellular structure is just like a beehive, that is a hexagonal. The honey bees are constructing hexagonal shape. That concept and this concept will fit in very exactly. We also have the hexagonal shape for mobile cellular structure, and then frequency reuse plan is made. So one base station will be there in every cell site. Cell sites will be hexagonal shape. The entire area will be divided into different number of cells. The frequency will be reused in every cell. When we reuse the frequency, the number of we increase. Once you have number of cells, it is called space division multiplexing. If you use the frequency by multiplexing, then you can use the frequency division multiplexing and then time division multiplexing. When you use the frequency division multiplexing and time division multiplexing, if you give one time slot for one customer for speaking, then if you increase that number of time slot, you can increase the number of customers. Therefore, initially in the analog telephony, we used the space division by having number of cells. Using frequency division and time division multiplexing, we increase the number of customers and the number of cells increases. So three concepts, space division multiplexing, frequency division multiplexing, time division multiplexing, we were able to give more number of customers. So that is the concept of wireless mobile communication. The factors determining cell side, we want more number of customers to be supported. Therefore, we are using the multiplexing technology. Okay, and the cellular concept came because of that. Okay, so that is why it is called cellular communication, wireless technology. Cellular communication is made use of in mobile communication. And first, France, they gave the name Global System Mobile. Therefore, it is called a GSM technology. Okay, so that is why if that frequencies are limited, then channels will be limited. The power of the antenna is increased, then you will get the number of subscribers can be increased. That is dependent on that. But you cannot artificially increase the power of the antenna, because if you increase the power of antenna, the radiation effect is there, that electromagnetic radiation, that problem will come. And you must have the cells. So size of the cell is also dependent upon the number of the generation. And FDMA, TDMA, then the another concept, co-division multiplexing access, which comes into the third generation mobile access. So we will see now what type of technology, in what type of generation we are using. Okay, now coming to the cellular architecture as such, you find that here. So this is a hexagonal shape base station, BTS one cell. This is another cell. This is another cell. This green dot is the BTS position, and the customer will enter this one, and in air interface through BTS, he'll be connected to the main switching center. Then here the visitor location register and home location register, that nothing but database which keeps the data of the customer. And then a customer entering this base station, he gets connected to the MSC. The HLR finds out the authorization of the customer and then connects the customer if he is connected to the public switched landline network, or otherwise if it is another customer connected in the same company, then he goes to that MSC and finds out in what location he is there, and then he gets the, if it is in this cell, then he gets connected. If it is in this cell, it gets connected. That means one call generates from here, goes from here, air interface, from mobile switching center to another mobile switching center, it is a fiber interface. From mobile switching interface to the base station, it is a fiber interface. From here, air interface. From the base station, it is an air interface. And then our mobile will be moving from here. So handoff is there. When the moving from one place to another, the call should not be cut off, and that is called a handoff call concept. Okay. Now, I told you now the spectrum for both the frequencies is very important, that you have to see here. In the case of a GSM, we use 900 megahertz. That means for uplink 890 to 915, downlink we use the 935 to 950. And then you find that 200 megahertz, that is 200 kilohertz, will be used for uplink, and then 200 kilohertz will be used for that. One time slot is used for one customer. Now you have to remember, when I do the design and then survey, I have to build lakhs and lakhs of customer. How I am going to do that? That is very, very, very important here. And also you have to find that for constructing one conversation, I require uplink and downlink. Both should be synchronized. I should provide a bandwidth. And that is how I have to provide the spectral allocation. Remember, the spectral allocation is costing thousands of crores. And therefore, spectral efficiency is very much important. The design, how many bits I am going to pack per hertz, is very much important for the spectral efficiency. Okay. Now, I will now briefly go for various generations. Okay. The various generations of systems. Okay. I'll just, in the very beginning, I'm just telling the old telephone system, first generation. You find that it is only analog, okay, and then there is no data. Please remember, when the phone came, we were having only the voice, and there was no SMS also, okay. There are different type of telephone system for different type of countries, and then only thing is there was no inscription, and then only voice was there, and there was limitation of call. Phone was very bulky. People were not happy. We want to send messages. Another point, you find that I told you a time slot, and at that point of time, people were not using many time slots. They were vacant, and people want to send messages. Then they found that then only the concept of SMS came. Okay. So the SMS came in the second generation. Okay. So the SMS was introduced because of people were not making the internet. The density of the communication was not more, and the time slot was free. People wanted messages to be sent. So what they thought? So a German engineer has designed that 160 character. You all remember the postcard of post office, how many characters can be written. That there we fixed that it is only 160 character you can pack in a postcard. That limit of 160 has been built into the SMS. And the free time slot available in the system, this message was sent as a channel in the time slot, free time slot as SMS. Therefore, you remember the SMS is not a pure data. The SMS is not a pure data. If MMS is a data, what you send message in WhatsApp is a data. Okay, if you have a telephone instrument, that is you have a 2.5G or 3G, when you send an SMS, it is going only on the TDMA time slot of the voice channel, and that is why there is a limitation of 160. You cannot send images and all. Okay, in the 2G technology, so TDMA was used, and then code division multiplexes started coming inside, the encryption started, and then in the data services started. Okay, circuit switching data service. Now we have to understand circuit switching. There are two things, data communication, all of you have heard about the packet switching. Then in the telephony, there is a circuit switching. Circuit switching means from a caller to the called party, we require a path for making a conversation. The path must be exclusively available to me, not only exclusively, but it should be available to me till the end of the conversation. So this is the concept of circuit switching. Till my conversation is over, nobody else can use that path provided for me. This is the concept of switch. Whereas in the packet switching concept, what will happen? Continuous bucket of packets will go to the destination in different directions and then get assembled at the destination. We need not establish a dedicated path for the channel. Okay, that is why that here first we introduce the circuit switched data. That is why there is a limitation. All of you please remember, circuit switch means for voice. Voice means it is only 56 kilobits per second. That means you cannot send more than that. More than 56 kilobits per second, you cannot have efficiency. So they wanted data, you cannot go beyond 46. Now what is to be done? So different technologies started coming. Okay, now that we will discuss. Now in the 2G, that 800, 900 and 1800 by 1900 megahertz bandwidth for 2G was used. So the signal was not sufficient when you use the increase in higher frequency, there was a drop, and then the data transmission was not at all sufficient and people were not happy. Okay, so therefore there was an improvement, 2.5G and then 2.7. So 2.5G, then packet radio service was. Now what they have done, what is packet, general packet radio? We use the GSM, we use that voice channel, that is a circuit switched network. In the 46, we used different coding techniques and then packed more. So CDMA coding, that is coding we have used, we increased from 53 to 153. Okay, GPRS initially you have seen 56 and then they packed up to 114. So the old, anybody having SIM card with the 2.5G, you'll be able to get only 114. That is because circuit switch, they use the coding technique, increase up to 114. Beyond that, they could not do. They went for code division multiplexing. They were able to increase the speed to 153. Okay. Then this become digital now. Previously, it was analog. Now it has the digital concept has come. And then we went to GPRS, packet radio service, because we want more data. So that is why the improvement started. We wanted to send IP packets to the internet. Okay. So the GPRS was integrated to the GSM system. Now the another problem is, whenever the technology is increasing, the operator like BSNL or Airtel, they are around 1,000 to 2,000 crores they are spending for spectrum, another 2,000, 3,000 crores per state they are spending for that infrastructure. Once one technology comes, for another 6 months, another technology comes, you cannot throw everything because they will be put into loss. Then the design of the technology is such that now GPRS has come, how to adapt, how to upgrade the existing technology without any demolishing the existing one. So that was the one, and that is why they told that integrated part of GSM network, of the GSM network switching subsystem. So that is how the GPRS was able to make. And in the GPRS, the network, we were able to have mobility, session management, and other things. Mobility management, then handover becomes better. Okay. And then what are all the protocol for internet protocols, and then billing and all, and then volume-based billing we were able to introduce, and then lawful interception. Please remember, whenever any mobile call that can be intercepted, lawfully it can be intercepted by the law enforcing agents. And then in the 2.75G, enhanced data, GSM evolution, enhanced data, GSM evolution. That is the meaning of this. Okay. Now, there was a project by India International Telecommunication Union, 3G partnership project, our the GSM specification. They brought in GPRS because they wanted the data to be done. They combined GPRS with GSM for making it backward compatible. Now, the data speed is not sufficient. They want to already started defining 3G. Okay. Now, what is to be done? Now, immediately before going to 3G, they want to have intermediate. Previously, around 114 kbps was my speed. Now, they improved it to 236. That means time slot for one that they multiplied, coupled for time slots, and then increased their data speed. Initially, one time slot 56 they were able to give. By coding, they were able to go for 114. And then by adding the time slot, introducing a coding, they were able to increase the throughput to 473 kbps, okay, in this 2.7G. Okay. So this is the EDG, that is enhanced data over GSM evolution. In your mobile phone and the near the signal, the EDG will be there. Even nowadays, many of the customer providers are providing this facility. In your phone, it will be there if there is a EDG. If there is an EDG, take assured that your data speed will be only 473.6. This one. Now, 473 is not sufficient. And people are only not satisfied with your voice call. Now I want to have a video call. I want to increase the data speed. So that means more IP packets are being transmitted. That means per hertz I have to pack more number of IP packets. So then it came WCDMA, wideband code division multiplexing. That means it is a digital broadband. There are different versions from different companies. CDMA 2000, universal mobile telecommunication system, and then enhanced video data only. These technologies were introduced. These technologies are nothing but improved multiplexing technologies, improved cell design technologies. For example, the cell TDMA and FDMA, that is FDMA technology in GSM 2.5, frequency reuse we are missing. When frequency reuse, if the design is not okay, the frequency will get mixed. Therefore, in code division multiplexing, then in code division multiplexing is there, same frequency can be used in all the cell site, then frequency mixing will not take place. So that problem was avoided. But some other extra problems came because higher power, higher radiation, control of the antenna, all these things came. But however, the CDMA technology has overcome those problems and they were able to go up to a 3.1 Mbps. Please remember, in 3G technology, theoretical was 3.1, but generally we used to get only that. That is why it was not very popular, but it became popular because it was able to give video call. Okay, and then the frequency spectrum was used was, okay, 2100 megahertz. Initially GSM it was 900, and here in 3G we are using 2100, and then bandwidth is, you see, allotted is it's only 15 to 20 megahertz. What was the drawback? So in 3G, we have to replace the broadcast tower. That becomes it's costlier. Operators, it is very costlier. You cannot just like that go. So it becomes expensive. That is why 3G was not very popular world over. And then in 3G, still researches were going on, 5, 3.5, 3.7, 3.9, in that high-speed packet access. That means 3.1 in 3G, 3.1 Mbps. Now, high-speed packet access, even that many of you may have in your phone, near this signal, there will be a word called HSPA. If that is there, high-speed packet access, and that will give you 3.6, one version, 7.2, up to peak rate, data rate is 14.5. Please remember, the version generation of technology is because of data hungry. People were data hungry, people were video hungry, people were speed hungry, and bandwidth hungry. That is why the technology is improving. Okay, and fairly high data range up to 5.76 Mbps in HSPA, and that is the version of 3.5, and then going to 3.10. Okay, and that also came to India and people there, and then you can find here cost per bit. So that is another point. That is bit per hertz is the spectrum efficiency. Okay, and then cost per bit, that means the equipment cost. But that means if the design, if I'm packing more and more megabits capacity data rate, that means its cost should not increase. So in the design itself, cost per bit is getting reduced. That is because of I'm using orthogonal frequency multiplexing access. Okay. Now I will this you find in this slide how a GSM network is getting adapted to GPRS and then getting adapted to CDMA. How the operator is adding the network. When the new technology comes, how the old technology is not thrown away. It is added and then upgraded. And that concept visually I have provided. It has got an animation. So I will just click, you can see. Now I am going to add GPRS data. Now serving GPRS packet node is added. GPRS backbone, it is a gateway. When I go from one network to another network, gateway GPRS node, and it is IP backbone. Anybody making a data call, that means you want to send a message, it will go to SGSN and GPRS backbone, GGSN, that is gateway GPRS node, and via this, it will go to the internet cloud. That is how from your mobile, via BTS, the data will go. Now you find the CDMA, that is the 3G, that BTS is getting added. Now, this particular situation, the BTS and base station controller of mobile switching center, that data network is added. Now, 3G network green, that is getting added. The software is getting upgraded. That means 2G, this is 2G, and then this is 2.5, 2.7, it is getting added. This is the 3G. That means the network is getting upgraded without any extra cost. That is, only the operator is adding cost to the extra equipment and not upgrading the original equipment, and that is the advantage. And bit per cost is getting reduced, and then certain efficiency is increased, and then data rate is increased, and in 3G we are able to make a video call, and simply because we are able to use wideband coarse division multiplex access technology. Coarse division multiplex is, and you would have seen in the multiplexing technology situation that it is only power oriented. It is like that in one room, so all different languages you can speak at any higher volume, it will not get disturbed. That concept is made use of in the code division. Otherwise, if two English people, more than two or three, they are speaking only English, the same frequency mixing happen. That is the problem of FDMA. If I'm speaking in one time slot, in the same time slot, somebody is speaking the same English, then that gets mixed. That is the problem in TDMA. In code division, all the people having different languages can speak, still get mixed. That is why I tell you, in the cell, any number of customers, adjacent cell also, you can use the same frequency. And then because of the code division multiplexing, these inter-channel interference, co-channel interference, inter-channel interference, inter-cell interference, all these type of problems will not come. So this is the evolution of technology from 1G, 2G to 3G. Inside decimal point, 2.5, 2.7, all these things I told you, they are gradual increase of facilities of the network which is provided in the decimal. Okay, now let us see now how the global evolution. Now 1G, then 2G, 3G, you have seen high speed data access because of the CDMA I am using. And it was only 14.4 in 2G, 144, because I used the high speed circuit switching and then packed with the coding. And then high speed packet access, this is circuit switching, this is a packet switching, I am able to go for 384. Okay, and then it has now, from 3G, it is going to 4G and then long-term evolution. Now, Aircel and all, they have come to 4G and they are in the long-term evolution. That means they want to have one technology to go for different companies. So different technologies, different people from countries, they have used to develop so many things. They don't want that. Okay, the CDMA from Japan, this one, all these things are there. Okay. So now what is the thing? Another point in the 4G, now you see wireless LAN, I told you Wi-Fi 802.11, 802.11, N, and that is growing, and ultimately this is going to come and then merge with the 4G. So that means now mobile communication with mobile handset, it is coming, growing the technology towards 4G, and then the Wi-Fi, Bluetooth, these type of things, technology are growing. They are going to merge in the 4G and then 5G era. So that is what we have to appreciate, because all in one, no longer I can wait Wi-Fi to be standalone. That means today it is an order of the day. When I come from a car using my cell phone, when I reach near my house, my cell phone identified I reached my house, tell the Wi-Fi that I reached the house, I will transfer my call to you. You take handover so that the bill on the mobile phone will get reduced. That type of system is now coming in the 4G. Okay, so this is how the technology system is growing. At the same time, you have to see the nomadic means is only walking, and then vehicular, when you go for higher speed, how the technology is getting adapted. So 2G is medium vehicular, the higher speed it cannot support. When you want to go for 250 kilometer speed, now LTE long-term evolution is supporting. That is also one of the very important thing. You find that 3G is not supporting, it is supporting only medium vehicle speed. When you go for higher speed, the 3G will not get supported. Whenever there is a problem, one is speed, another is the data rate, another is the vehicular traffic. Okay, all these things. So peak major benchmark, which has an impact on the evolution, is one is the peak, that is data rate, another is the mobility. So these are the two issues. And then merger, now we are going towards merger between the wireless local area network and then mobile communication network. So this is the point. Okay, now this WiMAX was introduced in India. Now that has been withdrawn because it is 802.16 or something. Okay, 802.16. WiMAX technology was there, one of the things that it was there. This situation, wideband broadband system. Now that is withdrawn by BSNL. Other local operator, they don't have that now. Okay, I am just showing you the previous example, mobile cellular system. 2.5 3G, 3.5 to long-term evolution. So the circuit switching was there. I already explained to you what is the circuit switching. Then circuit switching could not give the different speed. Therefore, we went to the packet switching, and then it went to long-term evolution, is 3.9. And now we want to have mobile broadband wireless access system. No longer now wireless technologies. No longer it is a mobile communication. It is going to be mobile broadband with wireless access system, and that is going to be 4G. There the merger is going to be taking place. So that is a fixed line, that is a mobile IP. Mobile IP concept is there, you know, whenever mobile is moving from one place to another place, how the IP address is being this one. Okay, home address, and then home address, and then visiting location address, agent node, all the concepts are coming. Okay, that means wherever your mobile go, your IP address is, you need not worry about the IP address changes or not. Okay, so that is being taken care of. So wireless broadband system and then mobile cellular system, they go and get married, and then we are going to have one mobile broadband wireless access system. Now, this I already discussed, it's only for a chart. When I'm sharing this, it will be useful to you. And now, only thing is, now the throughput rate, they see, we started from analog to digital, and then came to digital broadband, and then mostly it is only say all IP. And then from 1G to come from 14.K, then speed increase. Now today in the 4G, we are now talking about, this is, you know, 100 to 300 Mbps. And technologies, advanced high speed packet access plus, different. We had the TDMA, CDMA, then we had the GPR, there was the code division multiplexing, enhanced video data only. Okay, like that, the technology is getting increased. So this is the situation. Okay, so now as a user point of view, now you look at it in another angle, technologically, because you are all technical people. But the technological point, if you see, one is this 1G, only analog was there, then it became digital wire, then it became mobile broadband, I should make a video call, then mobile broadband, I told you how mobile broadband and then mobile communication started getting connected, and then 5G, it is going to become a total connected world. So 1980s, and now 90s I covered, 2000 I covered, now 2010s I covered the 4G validity. I am going to cover now 4G, and then 20s I am going to discuss, and then I will discuss about 30s also. We have got another 1 hour. Okay. Now, so one is number of connections for the provider. Another is the latency. See, what is the what latency matters here? If it is a voice, okay, that means I'll just give you one example why latency is going to create. I am sending my video clip to you, and no matter at what time it reaches you, because the latency is not going to create anything. But it's a telemedicine system. A doctor does this one, you know, seeing the patient and then making an operation. The instant at which the report is going to be received at the operation table is going to matter. That it is even one millisecond is going to matter. If it is an aircraft and fully connected aircraft and we're landing, any critical information has to be passed. The time at which the data is sent and the time at which the data is received, there cannot be any difference more than less than a nanosecond or a millisecond. It is going to become nanosecond. You take a case of smart grid in 220 kVA, a tower line is getting snapped and the entire city is going to be getting into the dark blue. The instant information to be received is the control, so that they can make a rearrangement, and there the latency plays a very important role. And you find that from 1G to 2G, 3G, you analyze only the latency in the table, what I have given earlier, you find that the latency is going on getting reduced. That is one of the benchmarks for growing to other technicians. Then another is the speed. Speed is the bandwidth. This is in megabits or gigabits. And now we are going towards a terabits requirement. Okay, so that is how the technology is growing from 1G to 5G and then 6G. Now, I'll just make a few mentions about 4G. I already now we have discussed why we want 4G. We want more bandwidth. We want a full motion video to be transmitted. Video conferencing we require. These things are not there. LANs cannot be getting integrated in the existing network. Wireless LANs, I already told you that requirement in the earlier table. We want integration of wireless LAN, wider bandwidth. Okay. And then we want to have a structurally more efficient modulation schemes, and we want to have fully utilized IP and then converged video and data. That is more important. Okay. So, okay. So there is a need for 4G has come. Now, how that is now built up? Okay. In 4G, okay, all IP, and then voice also is IP. That is why now many of you, I think Jio and Airtel and even BSNL people started giving these mobile phone to you. Many of you may be having. You find that it is written as VoIP near the signal, okay, on your phone. And for some people, it is written as LTE near the signal. These things are all coming, you know, they are all going towards 4G. That is the meaning. There, even your voice is on IP. If suppose IP is 6, and then orthogonal frequency division multiplexing is there, and single carrier FDMA, multi carrier, and then downlink 100 Mbps. And then uplink is 50 Mbps. Always it is dissimilar because uplink is less. That is why it's called asymmetric. That the technology is asymmetric because uploading is information is more, the downloading is information is more than the uploading. Okay, and technologically operators are more advantageous is using these asymmetric link. Okay, and then technologies, long-term evolution, high-speed packet access, okay. So, and the specification is left to the operator, depending upon the design, they can do their own thing. Now you find that 4G technologies, I tell you now, so here is a Bluetooth, right? And then here, this is a GSM, right? And then the WiMAX technology, then you have the GPS here. And then here is a Wi-Fi. Okay, here there is a video broadcasting, cable TV. All these things are integrated. Please remember, This slide is very important to understand the concept. And then you move it and multi-hub. It supports multi-hub communication and GSM. Okay. And then the multi-hub, you combine more than one laptop and then have it in the Wi-Fi mode. And that is getting connected via Wi-Fi to the tower, to the internet. The Bluetooth connected to the laptop is getting connected to this internet. Okay. All of them are connected to the internet. And that convergence is taking place. That means mobile broadband and then 3G mobile communication, all of them are getting converged in one location. That is why I told you, when you are moving in a vehicle and your mobile is able to sense where is your Wi-Fi point is there, the call is getting transferred. In IoT environment, your fridge, which is connected in your house, is ultimately connected to the repair wala and a network. He gets a message if something goes wrong, and he finds out through his own network and then attends to the repair remotely, or otherwise he comes and then returns. Or the availability of say milk or whatever it is, if it is connected in IoT network, the milk level is goes low, it informs an IoT network to the milk vendor that milk level has gone down, you have to replenish. That fellow keeps the milk and then sends a message that on the internet to the owner that while going home, please pick up because your fridge has informed me that there is no milk. So she takes the milk and then goes there, and then when she enters, then the door automatically opens and then she, and it replenishes and then informs that the vendor that milk is received and then I am okay. And that is possible only when the integration takes place from the mobile broadband network like Wi-Fi and this one, and also the mobile network. And that is made possible in the 4G technology. And that is what precisely this slide is telling. Now, taking the 4G technologies, okay, the 3G partnership project working on high-speed packet access, they use orthogonal frequency division multiplexing for uplink and downlink. Okay, it can be constructed using the existing network. I told you it can be upgraded. I already shown you this one, how 2.5 upgraded to 2.2, 2.5, 2.7 and 3. Same way this 4G also can be upgraded. Backward, always just like a software, it is backward compatible. So downlink will have 100 Mbps and uplink 50 Mbps. Natural upgrading is possible. Okay, so this WiMAX advanced, you know, that India, it is not coming now because WiMAX has got its own some drawbacks and other things. So we are not going to that. Okay, so that is with respect to say 4G. Okay, so now my dear participants, are you comfortable? And then your learning level is okay. Shall I continue? And what is the question? Your question. Now I'm going to discuss about 5G and then 6G. Up to this, is it okay? Learning level is okay. Am I clear to you? Hello? Hello?
Yes, sir.
Is it okay?
Yes, sir. It's too fine, sir.
Shall I go further?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Thank you. Okay, now, coming to, you have seen 2G, 3G, you have seen 4G. Now, why I want to go to 5G? Okay. That means, what are the parameters? Mobile data, volume, connected devices, latency, data rate, and battery life. These are all the benchmark which drives me to go for 5G. And this is one of the very important area of research for people doing PhD or postdoctoral. So a very important area is the battery life, and then the latency reduction techniques, and then volumes. Okay, there are different type of concepts are there. You can start working on that. Okay, so now, earlier slide, whatever I explained, what are the challenges and gaps in the 5G? You start reading from the bottom. Bottom is the long-term evolution, that it is the 5G. The latency is 30 to 50 milliseconds. 5G I will get 1 millisecond latency, end to end. So 50 times there is a gap in the existing technology for 4G, which is still not fully come to India. Okay. Next is the throughput. You see, 100 Mbps is only they are going to assure in for 4G. That is a long time evolution. Now 10 Gbps throughput is you are going to get in 5G. That means in your mobile, okay, if you can see 10 Gbps, how it will flow information, how it will flow, you can, how fast you can just, I cannot imagine what is going to happen to your mobile 10 Gbps speed. Okay, 100 times gap is there. Now it is going to have a breakthrough. Then have the mobility. See, in the 1G, now Nordic, I told you, it is only for walking in 1980. Within, say, 40 years, now what happened? It has come to 350 kilometers drive you can make, and then still the call will not get. Video call, multimedia can be transmitted. That is not still sufficient. We want to have 500 kilometers per hour high-speed railway. That means 1.5 times increase in the speed. Now, connections. See, this is another area. Here, IoT dominance is coming. Device-to-device communication is coming. Okay. So, billions of IoT devices are getting connected. Per head, I told you earlier that minimum six number of devices are getting connected per individual is multiplied by the number of population. And then the density connections, you know, per square kilometer, you are going to have 1,000, that is one followed by six zeros. Okay. Around 10 lakhs, six zeros, around 10 lakhs. One kilometer square, if you take, 10 lakh connection is going to come. Now it is 10,000. When 10 lakh connection in 1 square kilometer is coming, each one of them are going to have an IP address. They are going to be connected to the network. Now the mobile network will take care. No, not at all. The present network cannot take care. Then, now it is a physical network. You will not be able to get the software-defined networking, network function virtualization in this. Here, in the network architecture, the required ability of network slicing. I'll just explain you what is slicing, and then this is not seen now, so far not seen, and that is going to become a reality. So we are going to achieve the latency, throughput, mobility, number of connections, and then changes in the network architecture, and that is the 5G. Okay. So what I am going to do now, all home appliances, medical equipment, everything going to be connected to each other. IoT communication application and machine to machine communication is going to be the order of the day. So we want to have end-to-end ecosystem to be a fully mobile and connected. So far, the concept of connected society is not there. If you want to make a call, you get connected. In IoT, it is not there. Always it is connected. But are you going to provide that service? So the 5G will provide a new user experience. To provide the new user experience, what is the standards, technological standard? So we have to provide enhanced mobile broadband, massive machine-to-machine communication, ultra-reliable, low-latency communication. That is 1 millisecond communication. More number of devices are connected. What are you going to do? So enhanced mobile broadband. So these are all the specifications for 5G international mobile telecommunication 2020 is the vision. Okay. So that International Telecommunication Union has classified this mobile broadband, enhanced mobile broadband, low latency communication, and then machine to machine. Okay. So enhanced mobile broadband, what is the meaning of that? All of you are having TV in your home. TV, whether You are having standard definition TV or high definition TV? Standard definition TV, okay, around 300 Mbps is required. Okay. And then it is double that of you require for a high definition TV, for a one channel. Okay. For example, now I tell you, for 300 channels, and we have designed and then provided 1 gigabit transmission for standard definition. Okay, that means it will come around 30 Mbps. And for high definition TV, we have provided 2 gigabits to transmit 50 channels. Okay. Now, enhanced mobile broadband, if it has to provide videos and then virtual reality and then augmented reality video, that is, then minimum 30 to 40 Mbps bandwidth you have to provide each customer. So the that much of bandwidth provision you have to make. Okay, then low latency, consider this one. Okay, so low latency, where it, I already explained you, smart grid is there, and then automated driving, it has already come, many of the videos, of course now time is not, otherwise I would have put there some videos on that. Okay, patrolling, and then grouping vehicles will, without driverless it start vehicle, because it has got all IoT devices, it can sense a signal, front it can sense, back it can sense, and both sides it can sense, route it can see, so no driver is required. That means so many devices are connected across the road and group moving along with the other vehicles, and then remote managers. So that is already has come in other countries, that is called automated driving. That means you sit in the vehicle and then say what destination you want, and then map it, sit, and then it drives on its own, and then when the reach area destination is reached, it says you have reached. So that is the reality. That is the low latency, where their latency, see, there cannot be delay. So right, and then machine to communication is the densities. Now take a case of smart city and then smart agriculture. Smart city means the entire city will be connected with the IoT devices. Then millions of devices will be connected. Then all the machines will start communicating with each other. So what are going to do for that? Okay. So the 5G is an example. Okay. Then next thing is called the network slicing. Okay. See, the concept of network slicing, okay, is the virtualization of the network. See, what is the network slicing? See, for example, for Chalapathi College of Engineering, they want internet connectivity. So the service provider will say, we want 10 Mbps. They configure and then provide 10 Mbps. Okay. Suppose night time in the college is closed, the network is not used for the provider. He is not making use of it. Okay. That means it is configured and the reality basis, it is used exclusively for your own. Okay. In other words, what I am now will do, when college is open, when college will finish, or whenever the students log in, what is the requirement of your bandwidth? For that duration, that bandwidth will pump into your network. That slice only will give. It is equivalent to, I get a bread, there are so many slices, all the slices in the entire bread is for not me. Some of the slices I may take, some of the slices my wife take, some of the slices my daughter may take. At that particular point of time, which slice is meant for you, I decide and then give you. That way, a bread, the whole bread is equal to 10 Mbps. The slice is for 10 students are using at a particular point of time, rest of them are not using, that means 2 slices are used, rest of them are in the shelf. That concept, this is called a network slicing. Presently, that is not possible. But multi-protocol label switching, virtual private network, one concept is there, the operators are there. There they will provide 10 Mbps. There you can provide virtualization. How virtualization they can provide? For the head of the department, they can exclusively configure 2 Mbps out of 10. That means the 2 will not be used for the students on the common scale of 10. Well, only balance 8 they can use. That facility is available now. But it is not on real-time basis. Only when group of students log in, this slice is given. Night time, nobody is log in, that bandwidth is given to somebody else. This type of concept is called a network slicing. Here, quality of improvement will increase and the revenue stream for the operator will increase. So this is the idea of network slicing in the proposed 5G architecture. Okay. Then another point is the concept of femtocell. I think my friend Nagaraju is there on the line. He knows very well. It is one of the things. Small BTS provided inside your house, that is called the femtocell. It is there. The concept is there. The 5G is going to make use of it. Now, please remember, the 4G and 5G, the BTS cell footprint is going to become smaller. What do you mean by that? In Chennai area, when 3G was there, we used to have around 250 sites, base transmitting stations, BTS sites. When 3G came, it became 400. Now 4G came, the number of sites will become 700, 800 like that. That means, previously, every 5 kilometers in the olden days, if you see, only when you go after 5 kilometers in the national highway, we'll get another BTS coverage. The radius of the cell was larger then. Now the radius of the cell is becoming smaller and smaller. The footprint of the cell site is becoming smaller, and therefore the operators has to build more number of cell towers. Okay, the cost will increase. The design has to be done in such a way the cost has to optimize. Therefore, if you want to have a low latency in 5G, you must have high capacity cell base station and low power consumption. The power also has to be reduced. When the frequency bandwidth is more, it goes beyond the high frequency range, then the radiation effect is more. Electromagnetic radiation problem will come. Therefore, when we go from 4G, 5G and 6G, this point also has to be attacked, whether it is within the radiation limit, how the protection has to be done. If you want to do that, 5G radio access network architecture, there are three concepts. You have to densify. Densify, I already explained. In a per square kilometer, number of BTS will become more. Cloudification, disaggregation. So now I will give you these three concepts. What are the concepts in the 5G? One by one. Now, densification. Number of cells is getting increased per unit area. That means more fiber is required to get the connectors. That means greater fiberization for cell towers. That means all the cells, number of cell towers are increasing. So they have to be interconnected to the main switching network. Okay. And when it is densification is one of the challenge, that means more towers, more smart antennas, height will become reduced and power radiation will be more, electromagnetic radiation compatibility has to be taken care of. So this is one of the architecture to be taken care of, densification. Cloudification, okay. Now what is the cloudification? What is the concept of cloud? So all of you are now probably teaching software as a service, hardware as a service, and all these things, SaaS and in the cloud computing environment, the idea is, I am not able to invest 40,000 for a computer. Somebody provides a key and then some intelligent device without any hard disk and all. They say, I provide a cloud service. You pay, say, 400 rupees, 500 rupees a month. I get connected. The thing is that everything they provide for upgradation, evolution, maintenance, they take care of. So hardware, centrally, they are providing. Soft, Windows 10, everything, centrally, they are providing. For my house, if I have one display and then one control device and then internet connection, it will do. This is called cloud. See, now, for as an individual, this is the cloud. For a big organization, you provide a cloud server and then take the services for hardware services and then software services. Software. The same thing is to be introduced in a mobile communication network. Why there is a need for cloudification? Okay. Now the problem is, now you are downloading a recent video. Everyone in your town is downloading the video. That means the video is coming from content delivery network, the content delivery network in Hyderabad. Every minute, In your town, there are 100 people seeing the same movie. The content is getting delivered to you right from the server from the Hyderabad. The network, you remember, mobile network, main switching center, then base station controller, and then E-Node B, and then your mobile device. The entire network is getting, congested. If more number of devices are going to be connected, I told you number of times in the 5G specification, machine-to-machine communication, IoT. Now, what are you going to do? There is going to be jam. So 5G, they are now still thinking, if 100 people want to see the same movie, why do you bring it from Hyderabad? If it is provided from the Guntur BTS itself, Guntur nearest station in the cluster, 100 people where they are located, if everybody is going to be served from the BTS, you bring that content to that BTS, base transmitting station, start delivery. That means backside you are relieved. That is no congestion. For you, the contents are coming from your base station, which is nearer to your house, 500 meters away. That means the contents of the server cached and made to deliver, distribute from the base station itself. The base station is nearer to your cluster. Instead of bringing from Hyderabad content delivery server, it is brought to your nearest cluster head. That is the BTS. This is called cloudification. That is why they told, bring the resources to the street. In my street, if there are 10 customers, 10 people need the same content, don't deliver it from the source. Deliver it from the nearest street level. Bring the cash. Okay. Keep it there. The moment second person, third person, fourth person going to take it, the machine knows that they are going to have it multiple number of people. Bring the cash and then keep it there. Start delivering from there. Backbone network is released. This is the concept of, instead of the centralization is brought to the street level instead of the state level. So this is the concept of cloudification. Disaggregation. Okay. Now, you have seen in the 3G and 2G and all, there is a base station controller. There is a BTS controller, that is the base station controller. There is a mobile switching center. There is a home location register, which has got the data of all the people. For a gateway switching network for data traffic. Okay. They are hardwired. They are all hardwired. That, so every location, there is one MSC in Madurai, there is one MSC in Tiruchi, there is one MSC in Coimbatore, there is one MSC in Vellore. Like that, there are so many main switching centers. Now, what we will do, and they are all hardwired, the software is available only in a different location. Instead of that, you have only two planes, control plane and user plane. Centralize these softwares in one place, hardwares all in one place, centralize them, okay, and then provide the facility from a centralized location, that is the control plane. And then, so in the radio access network of 5G, instead of having one fixed hardware network, and instead of having one fixed software network lying over the hardware, have a centralized hardware, centralized software, and make a disaggregation of software centric control, and only the control plane and then data plane, they will start doing work. So this is the idea of disaggregation. Okay. In other words, if you want to, still it is a little difficult to understand this disaggregation network. Suppose now I tell you the disaggregation, that this control plane and the user plane, is, for example, I have taken one leased line from one service provider for Chalapathi College of Institute of Engineering, 10 Mbps. There will be one router in your Chalapathi Institute, and one router will be the service provider, and there will be a pipe of 10 Mbps will be configured via the hardware available, that is fiber and other things available by the service provider. This is not a disagree. This is not, this is an aggregation. This is not aggregate. Suppose you want to change the hardware, I have to go to Chalapathi Institute and then change the router. If any fault comes in the router in my native place, I have to change it. Okay. I have to do configuration, I have to do centrally. Okay. That is, and I have to change that one. Router, I want to change the configuration, I have to do that. Now in 5G, this concept is not there. That means your router for required for your Chalapathi College of Engineering, that box and the bandwidth, whatever is there, we have changed into the user plane and the control plane. User can do modification on his own. In the control plane, I can configure what type of hardware you require, what type of router you require for your end, and that is provided from my point. What type of bandwidth required, that is being configured from my point. So that is called, disaggregation. Okay. The next concept is network software, softwareization. Okay. Here the concept is network function virtualization and software defined network and edge and cloud computing. Edge and cloud computing, I explained cloudification. Network function virtualization, software defined, this one is the disaggregation. Okay. That means softwareization is embedded across all network layers. Okay. Leveraging software defined networking and network function virtualization. Now, I will just give you a brief about what is NFV and what is software defined networking. Now, on my left hand side, you see, it is a classical network. All the router, firewall, PE router, broadband RAS, everything available. This is the classical network. This is what we do now. Think of network function virtualization. I already explained to you the concept, network slicing. That is the virtualization. Now, high volume servers, high volume storage, high volume Ethernet switches are all provided in my place. And then software, whatever required for all the customers I provided here. I want to connect Chalapathi Institute, I want to connect Vasavi Engineering, I want to connect NIT. Provide only the physical connectivity and the router, what is required for at the location of Guntur can be served from the central location. This is called the virtualization approach. The network has made to work virtually from this one. So NFV is about implementing network functions and software functions running on the top of industry standard hardware instead of dedicated hardware. Dedicated hardware, this one, classical on left hand side. You want a content delivery network, you must have it in central places. You want to have a router, the service provider should have a router at each location. Okay. The node has to be provided in location. Okay. So instead of that, I provide these high volume servers, high standard servers, high Ethernet servers, and then provide virtualization through the software instead of a dedicated software. And that is what a network function virtualization proposed in the 5G. Okay. So here, CapEx and OpEx, of course, this is all management things. So lawyer dependency and vendors and other things. So this is not a technical point. And then software defined network, it is altogether a different subject, but I can give you some concept, okay. The program control and managing the network resources, okay, which facilitate design and delivery operation and network services is dynamic and scalable. I'll give you an example. You go for a classical, Telugu musical functions. You say one there will be one violin and there will be one vocal artist and then there will be one mridangist will be there. each one of them are a communication device, let us assume. Each one of them are playing. They are integrated. And you hear the sound from mridangam, violin, and also the vocal artist. All of them are combined and through the mic and then mixer and then given. It is a traditional network of what we are giving. Now you go to orchestra, the orchestra, okay. Everything is centralized. Which note has to be done, but depending upon the music, that note comes, there it is, that concept is called the software-defined networking, the orchestra concept. There are a lot of musical instruments are there. Each one of them, the note is played, the note based on the note, which one has to be played and what, that mixing has been done. Okay. So, instead of directly this one, in a conventional music program, and this one, this is how we have to combine. The software-defined network is the one. I can give you another example. Here now, I have a network, software-defined network. Let us assume I have a company called Software STN implemented from Hyderabad, Guntur, Nellore, all location. I got the full network. If somebody in Guntur wants, say, 10 Mbps leash line connectivity, simply I will do, on my software, there is a user plane and then a control plane. Okay, in the control plane, I configure the location of the location ID of the end user, and then what type of hardware is required, what is the size of bandwidth is required, and I define, and that bandwidth is given. Then instantly you say that at any point when my demand goes up, this will be monitored. When 10 goes to 12, in the conventional network, beyond 10 you will not get. It will cut off. In software development network, when your demand goes from 10 to 12 to 13, 14, 15, it monitors and the customer agrees. I give in a configuration in my SDN that depending upon the customer's requirement, you increase that, this one. As you increase the volume manually, okay, assume that if I raise my voice, the volume increases automatically in the mixer. Like that, the software-defined networking, the customer's requirement is increasing, say from 2 to 3, 3 to 4, automatically the bandwidth is provided by the service provider to the network user, and that is the concept of software-defined networking. It's a very big subject. Okay, I'm just giving you only the two drops or three drops like that. Okay. What happened? Okay, now you find that here, for the service provider, the concept is there is a SDN controller, these are the application, these are the network resources. From the application, I require 10 Mbps. So I will say the network services, I will say I want 10 Mbps. Through the network resources, it will be provided to the customer. So that is the concept. That means we can programmable by application at the control plane, and then I can network resources. Network resources means what? The bandwidth, end-to-end bandwidth, then end equipment. Suppose if I provide a network, normally end, what are the type of equipment I have to provide? For connecting, what type of medium I have to provide? In the medium, what type of bandwidth I have to provide? These are all the specifications. Now, the medium is fixed. Bandwidth also is hardwired. In the SDN, bandwidth can be controlled by the application. Okay. End equipment hardware also can be controlled through the hardware. Slicing, network slicing can be done. Network virtualization can be virtual network. That means, see, in another way, I can say, what is network function virtualization? Suppose now Chalapathi Institute has got 10 sister organizations. You won't connect 10 sister organizations with the Chalapathi Institute. Now, I have to physically hardwire all the institute and then pay lakhs and lakhs of rupees to the service provider, and then you do. Once fixed, one institute either you want to increase the bandwidth, or one institute you don't want the bandwidth, you have to give 1 month notice. now in this software defined that is not there. The moment I want more than 2 MB, automatically the rate increases. The moment I don't want, then it gets closed. From this application level itself, it gets closed. I need not go to the customer process and change the hardware and all. So that is called network function virtualization. I am able to provide a virtual circuit between the 10 sister organization and the Chalapathi Institute amongst my network, which is virtually available, but exclusively available for you with all security features. Okay, that is called software-defined networking. Okay, so benefits, customization, faster business cycle, okay. And see, the network resources, I told you, night times 10 Mbps for an academic institution, they will not work, but I cannot divert it now. So much of bandwidth is lying vacant for me. In this virtualization, that bandwidth, night times, it will be made use of by somebody, but it will not be billed to you. That is the advantage here. Okay. And that is done by separation of control plane and then user plane. Okay. So you see the control plane and then user plane. Control plane for all the how the network services are provided, and the user plane, how the user defines his requirement. Okay. So, and all the user planes, they will be under the control plane. The entire network, previously the 3G, 2G network, physical network I have shown you, and the one slide I have shown you in the 3G animation, there the hardware is coming, and I told you software is installed. In every stage I am doing, but in here, the entire network is divided into control plane and the user plane. User plane and the application controls are there. In the control plane and the hardware and other way, using the software-defined networking and network function virtualization, they are provided. So in 5G, the control plane and then user plane are divided. Okay. And then the edge computing, I told you, I just wanted to show you here. See, this is the Hyderabad content delivery network. This is a cluster of location street. Every time the content is coming from here, so that the network is getting congested. Instead of that, the content is now pushed, the logic is pushed to this edge. The delivery will be made from here and not from here. Therefore, the network is released from here to here, from this point to this point. That means the entire network, there is a latency from this point to this point. When the content is shifted to this point, the latency get reduced because the network length is only this much. And this is called the edge computing, and this is called the cloudification. Instead of delivering the content from the central location, the content is pushed to the edge of the network. Edge of the mobile network is the base station. From there, customers are provided air interface. And for them, it is delivered. So either it may be a BTS, or it may be a base station controller, or it may be a mobile switching center. Depending upon that, it can be done. So this is called edge computing. The computing and storage resources are available in the street level, or that is the next to user level. Okay, so in the edge computing, okay, so the benefit is for autonomous devices and immersive experience, we are getting the virtual reality and other things. So because there is no latency, we are able to control all these things. So ultra low latency, backhaul and then core network traffic is getting reduced because of the caching. The big data is coming nearer to the user. And then the basic concept is in-network processing. That means the data is processed where it is generated. That means this is one of the in-network processing is one of the concept of wireless sensor networking. And because in wireless sensor networking, the data is processed where it is generated. So here also it is brought. Okay. Network slicing, I already explained to you. Okay. And then network slicing and shift. And then this can be fulfilled in three ways. One is small networks, and then I'm connecting that more number of devices. Okay. And then having MIMO antennas, multi input, multi output antennas. And then this I already told you, this one, what are the speed, you know, up to 20 gigabits speed, mobility 500 kilometers, and then data rate, battery life is 10 years. This is one of the very important thing. So here your research area, people can do research, okay. And then latency is less than 1 millisecond, this is another thing. End to end, it is a 5 millisecond, okay. Data speed is 10 megabits. Okay, so this is the specification. And now this is the 5G overview, okay. How the control and then network layer, control layer, and then function layer, they are separated, okay. So one network and multiple industries. In 5G, this is the concept. Any number of devices can be connected. And then expectation, what we get is the global standard, machine to machine, personalization of mobile TV. So these are all the things, okay. So now I'll just peep into the 6G system, okay. Now we have the 5G, we have the connected things. Okay, 5G is focusing on IO, that is a machine to machine connected things. Now it is going to be a connected intelligence in 5G, 6G. Okay, and then we are going to have ubiquitous artificial intelligence, right? So how the connected intelligence is applied? Now this is small bucket. When I share that slide, you can see here in one slide what I have given here in lecture, everything is given. And then in 2030 in 6G, I'll just bandwidth 3 terabits, 3 terahertz bandwidth. 1 terabit per second is the speed. Spectral efficiency, I told you, 100 bits per second. Now, in this, if you see the spectral efficiency somewhere, see, spectral efficiency in 5G is 30 bits per second. Okay. And if you come down, it will increase, spectral increase, it will become low. So 5G, 30 bits per second, 6G it is 100 bits per second. That is, it is more than 3 times. Mobility 1000 kilometers, latency 0.1, less than 0.1. And then see the application, digital video broadcasting. I told you television broadcast, 3-dimensional communication, sensory and digital sensing. All these things I will just to make a mention in the following slides. Okay, so terahertz visible light frequency band, and then wireless power charging, harvesting power for the battery from the sunlight, intelligence, artificial intelligence in a big scale, then blockchain technology, all going to be inbuilt in this one. So main thing is now speed, and then battery life is going to be very important. That is the key features of 6G. Okay, enhanced mobile broadband, quality of experience, because the connected, it is not connected things, it is a connected intelligence. Okay, so what the vision is, one is big communication. Okay, that means big communication means, now we have infrastructure, village level the infrastructure is idle, rural, in urban level infrastructure is very much used. In rural, my investment is becoming now unutilized, you know. In 6G, the big communication, there will be one infrastructure, and if village, if less traffic, that can be made use of in urban. That concept is resource balancing, allowing subscribers to communicate with one another everywhere with the high data. Suppose if there is a high traffic, my bandwidth is getting reduced. In village, if there is nobody is there, the bandwidth is okay. That uniformity is not there. In the big communication concept, extremely larger bandwidth, okay, and high artificial intelligence will be the aspect of this network. Okay, then ultra reliable, low latency. That means the reliability, 99.9 7 nines after point, that is 7 nines. That means that the reliability is another very important. That means where reliability is what? When there is a handoff from one BTS to another BTS, when you are moving very speed in a high speed train, when the handover is taking place, the call is getting cut off. There you are not getting reliability now. The point 99 after that point 7 nines are there. That type of reliability is not there now. And the latency is more than 1 millisecond. Now it is 0.1 millisecond. And then security framework. So these are all the framework for ultra-reliable, low-latency communication. Then three-dimensional communication. Okay. So what is the three-dimensional communication? That means 3D videos. Now, if you transmit 3D videos, you require a high bandwidth. Okay, from 2 to 3 dimensions, through which heights of communication nodes may be, number of nodes have to be increased, the footprint has to be increased, and then the 3D communication, 3D video has to be transmitted. Three-dimensional integrated communication is another vision. Then another vision is holographic communication. You have seen the hologram. That is, the hologram is the 3D technology which manipulates light rays beamed as an object. Okay. That means 3D communication with a stereo volume, you see. Now you cannot transmit on mobile, even in 4G, because it requires a high bandwidth, low latency, higher footprint. Okay. So in 3G, 6G era, in 2030, you are going to say reconfigurable stereo audio. Okay. That is going to capture several physical presences. That means 3D video with stereo voice is, that's the holographic communication. Okay, so that is going to be the design aspect of that. So I am not talking about the ITU paper, International Telecommunication Union. I have gone through some research paper, I have given an acknowledgement. And there, that is the vision paper they have put. And these are all the vision. Another is the tactile communication. What is tactile communication? Now the communication is verbal, whether it is a packet transmission or it is an analog transmission or a digital transmission, it is a voice or the video. Now, and it is a verbal communication. Now, we cannot transmit non-verbal communication. Non-verbal means handshaking, and then physical aspect, laughing, this one. Okay. You should not speak. At the same time, you have to communicate. That is called a non-verbal communication. The non-verbal communication, if you want to say namaste, you have to close both the hands and then smile. This has to be communicated to the other end. So this is called a tactile communication. Okay. So virtual vision close to real sets of the people, even in the non-verbal communication. Okay, holographic communication is a virtual visual communication. Okay, so tactile internet is a non-verbal communication. It is the real-time conveyance of image. I will only convey image on a real-time basis and sign and start sending communication. That is called a tactile communication. So that technology, beneficiary of the technology are teleoperation, cooperative automated driving, okay, and interpersonal communication. Okay, it is going to help these industries. Then human bond communication. In 6G, there is another concept called a human bond communication. That means 5 human senses: smelling, seeing, touching. When you touch, you feel the sparism, we call in Sanskrit sparism. Okay, so and then. Say, for example, now patient admitted in the hospital, they are on the ventilator, the breath is there. The breath sequence and then how much oxygen is growing, everything, communication, what patient feels, that has to be communicated on a real-time basis to the doctor. So that example is communication through breath. So this is called a human bond communication. Okay, so designing a communication mimicking 5 human senses, okay, it is a research area interdisciplinary. Okay, how to do that? This is because now whatever vision I am telling on 6G is wonderful areas for research. Even a bit of research will fetch you a very good credit. Okay, this is called the human bond communication. Now you can see, leisurely you can see. Anyway, I think I'm just crossing 6 o'clock. Another 5 minutes, please give me extension. Okay. Now you see, this is the free space optics. That is the communication, FSO communication. And that means free space optics means normally optical communication is through a optic fiber cable. Now there's no cable. Air interface. Light will be passed on the air interface. This is called free space optics. Software defined networking. Sensors, 5 sensors. And that is getting connected. Now 3D. 3D consultation, 3D story visualization, 3D gaming. Okay, machine to machine communication. Drone networking. Okay. Then robotic automation. Smart home. Then unmanned aerial vehicle, that means automatic vehicle. All of them are connected to the 6G communication tower. MIMO base station, ultra massive MIMO base station. This is the 6G network base station. For this network, you are connected there, say underwater communication, under the sea. Now there is, you know, you cannot connect underwater communication just like that. Okay. Then unmanned aerial vehicle. Sensory, that is a human bond, then holographic, 3D virtualization. Okay. All these things are networked, then e-health monitoring through the IoT, and then that is through these MTM. All these things are getting connected. Here you find autonomous vehicle. That means this is one MIMO base station, and this is one another MIMO base station. These two base stations are connected. There are 60 base stations. For this base station, all these things are connected. And then you can see the backhaul is given on the free space optics. That means on this building, there is a tower, there is a laser antenna, a laser beam, and here there is a laser beam. Through air interface, optical signal are passed, and then that is working as a backhaul. That is called a free space optic communication. There's another deep subject, very interesting subject. We can have a discussion later on. And then you find that in 2030, all of you will be there. Perhaps I will not be there. Okay, I am already 70. All you people are going to enjoy the feel, and then this one possible 6G communication architecture in which you are going to see sensory signals are going to be transmitted, and then human bond, physical feelings and everything are going to be transmitted to a distant end through the 3G, 6G architecture in the year, by the year 2030. Okay, so this is the, we have now, I have brought you now 1980 and then crossover years and 1980 and then 2030, you can find, you know, so 50 years, right? And story, how we are going to move. Okay, up to in 2020, we have the 4G, we have come. Okay, between 10 years, okay, somewhere in 25, you get the 5G, and 30, you will get the 6G. And when 6G will come, it is a wired network. Whatever reliability you got to wired network, you will get in a wireless network, wireless communication, that reliability will get. Bit error rate will come, and more features will come. Terahertz wireless communication. So we started with only small bits, and then kilobits, and then megabits. Now in the 2030, we will get the terahertz information system. Artificial intelligence, blockchain technology, all are going to come as outstanding concepts. And I think all of you, I would have gone asleep in dream. What are going to get in 2000? Unimaginable this one. All of you should get your syllabus will get updated for network function, virtualization, software defined this one. What is control plane, another thing. SDN is another subject by itself. It will be a paper. So all of us to get ready and get preparation of teaching the subjects to the student community and then doing research in the areas of what tactile communication, human-bond communication. All these new areas are coming. And then new technology, lot of breakthrough is there. Lot of research areas are there. I wish all of you good luck in your venture. And I kindly request all of you to come back from your dream and then switch back to 2020. Okay. 2020, and then now I open the session for any doubts or any question session. If it is allowed, then we can discuss and things.
Thank you, sir. Yeah. Thank you very much for your great session.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Any of you have doubts, please raise your hand, or otherwise you may post in the chat box.
I am just seeing the chat box only now.
If anybody is raised, sir, I will connect. Anybody is there?
Two people raised the hand in between, sir. Madam Lalita Garu and one more sir has raised the hand.
Any question I will answer.
Sir Nagaraju here from NIT Nagaland.
Very, very nice to hear Nagaraju.
Yes, sir. I
want to thank you personally.
Yes, sir.
Now introducing me to Andhra Pradesh. This is my maiden venture to Andhra Pradesh. I hope that I can do some service to Andhra Pradesh and my 50 years of experience can be put into use to the people, you know, okay, instead of getting inside, you know. I am very glad.
Very, very
I
want nice to lecture,
profusely
sir.
Thank Dr. Nagaraju to introduce to me too to Balamurli.
Sir, it's my honor, and I think all the participants also will appreciate that in given 2 hours time, you have taken us to the year which we were not born, to the year which we didn't see it till now.
Yes,
and you have covered the past, present, and the upcoming future also.
Yes, yes,
really,
yes,
it was a wonderful technical session, sir. Thank you. I think I really thank Chalapathi Institute of Technology, Dr. Balamurakrishna Garu, Udaykiran Garu. Really, sir, you are conducting a very unique sessions where a lot of knowledge sharing in the true sense is happening. I really thank all the CIT organizers on this.
Thank you, sir.
Some persons told that problem can be identified for research. This we can do. We can do a separate session. Only what research areas that has to be dealt separately. Here I assume the participants are mixed participant, and only just then and there I made a presentation. But pointing out the research, I think one Adi Lakshmi Grandi. She has asked, and then that can be done. Okay, I can help in that area. There is no problem. And then somebody want to have a PowerPoint to be spared, and then I can give PowerPoint. There is no issue. Yeah.
Madam Saswati Pratima Garu, I think you can unmute yourself because some people are raising hand. Udaykiran, sir.
I unmuted her. You please speak, ma'am.
Good evening, sir. Actually, I want to ask regarding the visual light communication application in 5G and 6G. Can you show some lights on that so that we can get it? Because my research area is on visual light communication.
I have some ideas on that. I can help you, ma'am. You can take my mail ID. Okay. You want only visual communication, you know, on 5G and 6G.
Yes. Related to 5G.
Visual communication in 5G itself is one good point because people have not thought over that. Visual communication in 5G, in the visual communication and caching is one of another good area. You can bring that to the BTS level, that visual communication load, and then start dumping to the customers inside. Okay, something like that. We can think of that. That is a good area, and visual communication, and then if you have to define that, and then if you define what is your requirement, then we can fit into the 5G this one.
Okay, sir. And one more question from your presentation. Sir, you mentioned that cloudification, whenever means anywhere the customer is means downloading the video, the through the cache memory means it is just transfer from the main server to the corresponding server where the user is present, right? So yeah. How this cloudification is happening technically, can you instill something, few points?
Okay, madam. See, for example, one movie is getting seen by a group of people in an area.
Okay. Yes.
In one street, let us say. Okay, that street into one particular movie. That means the server knows the lat-lan of the location and the cluster from BTS, in which BTS area these all the people are downloading. Okay. Now presently in 3G and 4G, there is no facility in the BTS to get those contents and then deliver. There is no facility now. So now what we do actually, see the content delivery server, which is available in the headquarter location, in the central edge location, going on sending the same packets again and again in the wireless network. So the wireless network is getting hanged. So yes. for this, what actually we do in IPTV, what we do, IP television concept. So there in the per street, you know, if there are 10 customers, 10 customers, they are supplied these IP packets from one modem. Okay. That one modem ID we know. Suppose the modem has got a hard disk. Those content, say for house one, I have sent 100 kilobytes. The moment I send, the modem should know that is required for second house also. Then it keeps it there. Then it delivers. When that delivers to second house, third house also there is a demand. That modem knows the third house also asking. So here there are two things. In the cluster of 100 houses, there must be a hardware and then intelligence built in the base station or nearest base station controller that in the cluster frequently this type of demand is there for a particular video. So what it does, then that when once first time when it get it downloaded in that BTS, it stores there. The next time when you want, the request will not go to the main server, but the cache memory itself identifies and then delivers to the cluster. That means the server available in the headquarters, it is now moved to the street level cache. You got the idea, ma'am? No.
Yes, sir. The idea I got, but I'm asking practically how the access
technology... Now what to do, what you have to do. See, you have to design the network. Now probably provide a hardware in the BTS. Okay. That means a hard disk with some intelligence. Okay. Whenever the package comes, it will pass through that. When it passes through that, any repeated request will be served from there itself. Now, for example, ma'am, YouTube, what they are doing, I tell you. YouTube, I'm downloading the videos again and again. It never comes from Singapore. Here in Chennai itself, in one Ambattur, there is a server. The second and third time when I'm asking, that server itself from my locality will come. That is why you find that YouTube is very fast, whereas WhatsApp is not. Okay. So in your research, what you have to do, first you have to define your mobile network. In the mobile network, where all the concentration point you want to define. In that concentration point, you have to provide cache memory with intelligence. That cache memory with intelligence will identify the locations where the packets once received, it will be repeated. And it will be sent when the request comes. It goes from the cache memory to the content server. Then content server says the cache memory you have, you give it. Something like that logic you have to depend and then do it.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Another is which type of access technology will be suitable for this? Can you means recommend?
Access technology, you select delivery of your film, movies and all through mobile. It is only mobile technology. Access is only radio network, that is the BTS.
Sir, access technology means I am asking about the channel access. Means can we go for TDMA, OFDMA, like now we are using OFDMA access technology for the 4G and 5G.
If you use 3G, if you use 4G, what is access technology they are used? They are used on
OFDMA. OFDMA.
You have to explore the possibilities that OFDMA, go deeper into OFDMA, then find out in which time slot that video slots are coming. Then you have to drop in your cache memory and then distribute it.
Okay, sir.
Understand that?
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
We have to go deeper into the mobile communication and then go deeper and then break the OFDMA, find out where in which time slot it is coming. Then that cache memory what you are providing will request the MSC, you provide me. Whatever you are sending there, that is repetition is there, please provide me. The lot of research papers are there on this. You go and say, if you search on caching for mobile communication, caching video on mobile communication, lot of research papers are there. Then you have to do some analysis on that and then come out with your new ideas.
Yeah, Santhana sir, Nagaraju here. Saswati madam,
yes,
you go to IEEE Communications Magazine, ma'am, from the year 2014. There are so many papers. You can try for a keyword something like proactive caching in 5G networks. You type this keyword, you will get many papers where different architectures are defined and different levels of caching. Like as Sari is telling, bringing the cache contents to the edge of the network is one thing. Whether you are going to keep in the BTS layer, the radio subsystem layer, or can you do in the network subsystem layer? Every layer has its advantages and disadvantages. All those things are available in different IEEE communication magazines.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. Sir, actually, I got a very good idea. And thank you for your valuable information also. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
So, any more doubt, participants? And
sir, no hands were raised, sir. I think you have cleared all the doubts.
Okay.
In your presentation itself.
Yes, sir.
From 1890 to 2030.
Yes, sir.
And you will be there for 100 years, sir. No worries about that.
Then I will have a session to Chalapathi Institute.
On right, sir. You are always
2003.
About
right, sir.
Definitely. See, the funny point is, I entered the telephone department in 1970, where there was only Morse code and then manual telephony was there. At the time, we never imagined a mobile telephony. There was no subject, mobile telephony itself was there in our plan, this one. Only manual Abraham, the Lincoln, that is a Samuel Morse and then this one, you know, Graham Bell. These two points only they were teaching us.
Yes.
Electromagnetic thing, okay. So I never thought that I'll be today and then teaching you a mobile fifth generation. That is a thing.
It was very most informative systems, most informative lecture, sir.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. Guys, shall we conclude?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Yes, sir.
I thank our management, Sri YV Anjaneyal Garu and Secretary Y. Sujit Kumar Garu for giving us the opportunity to conduct the webinars on various topics of engineering and research for the benefit of students, faculty and research scholars. I thank our today's resource person, not resource but he is an eminent person, Santhana Krishnan Garu, for their most informative lecture. I thank you, sir, for your most informative lecture. And I thank our EC department for supporting us to conduct this webinar. I thank R&D Dean, and I thank our principal, Kolla Nagasrinivas Garu, for giving me the opportunity. I thank all the participants from various locations. I thank everyone for their contribution to conduct this advanced wireless communication 5G and beyond 5G workshop.
thank you one and all. The feedback form is already sent in the chat box and the YouTube group. The YouTube video and PPT that was presented by our guest will be sent along with the certificate within 2 or 3 days. Thank you one and all for your patience listening. Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you very much, sir. Shall I leave the line?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay.